Scaling a successful global security operation is no small feat. It takes a level of commitment and culture of ownership that prioritizes customer trust while adapting to meet business needs. Hi, I'm Clark Rogers, Director of Enterprise Strategy at AWS, and your guide for a series of conversations with AWS security leaders here on Executive Insights. In this episode, I'm joined by Tom Avant, Director of AWS Response and Resiliency. Listen in as we talk about the keys to building, maintaining, and evolving security operations to ensure business resilience. Thanks for joining us. Well, Tom, thank you so much for joining me today.
Thank you so much for having me. I'm really honored. Appreciate it.
I'd love to start off with just a little bit about your background. I know you spent some time in the military, and then what sort of drew you to AWS?
Going into the military, I went into initially linguistics, right? So it was an intelligence analyst and worked and just got this great exposure to all different cultures when I was at Defense Language Institute in Monterey. Learned a lot about the world, which would come to serve me a lot better later on in life running global organizations and global teams.
Sure.
And then the intelligence, you know, industry, you know, is just, there's so much, you know, that you see on like the TVs and the movies and you think that's what it's like. And then you get in and you realize it's nothing like that. But it was a great place for me to be able to go and to learn a lot about data and about processing and having, you know, methodology to the way that, being methodical in the way that I thought and the way that I looked at things. So I did that. I worked in at NSA for a couple of years doing different, you know, stuff from an intelligence perspective. And then ultimately, when I became an officer as an air battle manager, a command and control officer running intelligence operations, I'm now doing president support. I'm doing, you know, humanitarian missions all over the world and making critical decisions and doing, you know, things that are all in the name of, you know, major global level incident response.
For sure.
So for AWS, it was like a natural fit. You know, I've been security for my whole life. I have joked before I've had security clearance since I was 19. So, but, you know, coming into an organization that had values. You know, Amazon was attractive because of the leadership principles. And when you get to understand what happens at AWS, like when you really dig in, you're like, oh my God, like so much of the world, you know, ticks because of the things that we do. I get to have a piece of that.
Let's talk a little bit about your current role at AWS. What is that current role and what are your responsibilities?
The primary thing is I run the AWS Security Operations Center, and then I also am responsible for AWS Business Continuity.
Okay.
So two very different things, right? But critically important to the business in both rights. So AWS Security Operations Center is responsible for tier one physical and logical incident response across the business. So anything from a data center to S3 buckets, right? Like, you know, we are in the front lines of making sure that we, you know, monitor detections and then either triage those detections or route them to the to other people who can fix them if we can't do it ourselves. And so for everybody wondering about their badge, right, like, you know, we run that operating system and we, you know, we do all the different integrations with that in order to make sure people get in and out of the spaces that they need to every day. And then also that you don't get into the spaces that we don't want you to get into.
For sure.
Right. So the access control is very important. The business continuity piece is the resilience of all of our operations and our services. Right. Like we attest and we say, hey, you know, we have redundant systems and we trust these systems and we tell customers, hey, you know, we know that this is going to be good. And we want to make sure that when we tell them that, they know that we're not just saying that because it sounds cool. We're saying it because we've tested it and we've got people in the background working tirelessly to go back and retest and use all of our different things, everything from, you know, operational risk reviews to, you know, COEs to, you know, different, you know, ISO requirements in order to make sure that our services really are resilient.
So I assume things like red teaming and stuff like that falls under you?
That actually doesn't. That's in a different part of the business.
Okay.
Yeah, but what we do is more like the TTXs or like the exercises where, you know, we'll do a full-scale exercise and bring in people from all different parts of the business. And it's essentially a simulation to say, okay, what happens if we have a bad day? How do we respond? How do we react? How do we make sure the right things happen? It never goes perfect. We learn so much stuff. We incorporate that. We put that in the run books. We share that with teams, and we go and we do it again.
Running a SOC is a huge investment from the business perspective. How do you justify the expense, or do you even have to, based on the type of work we're in? Because when customers, I have conversations with customers, they're like, well, I'd love to have a SOC, but it's so expensive, you know, the staff and the tooling and all this kind of stuff. How do I make the business case for it with my leadership that we in fact need a SOC or maybe even just a SOC service if they decide to subscribe to one?
That's a complex question. There's a couple of answers to it. the first part is because we're awesome, right? So that's how you justify it. But no, it's through KPIs and data. Mm-hmm. And, you know, we have QBRs with our leadership. So we consistently look at mechanistic ways to assess, are we providing and returning value to the business and to the customer?
Can you could you share any of the metrics that you use?
So there's tons of stuff that we're looking at in all the different business lanes in order to make sure that, you know, we're returning that value to the business. For our access control system, you know, we make sure that, you know, we talk about the system uptime. Okay. and you know, and what the system downtime is, right? And we make sure also that, you know, for different configurations that we apply, that we coordinate what is the net gain off of those changes that we've put in place. For detections, right, we look at mean time to detect, mean time to resolve. We look at the different types of detections we're coming in, and we look at the value that's returned to the business in those spaces. For business continuity, even we're looking at different metrics about, you know, the different services that we have, mm-hmm. you know, broad in scope, the ones that are ISO certified, the ones that we have, you know, have been able to make sure, you know, have gone through testing. Now, the other part of that question, however, is at the same time, and maybe this is just because I grew up as a frugal person, mm-hmm. but at the same time, like I really believe in that first tenet, like. Skill through humans is a last resort. You come to me, you say, hey, do I have a great idea for you? Do I think that this would be a great job for the SOC? Why do people say that? Because we're 24/7.
Right.
Right. And a lot of people are looking to offload something to the SOC, right? And they want to come over and say that. And I say, you know what? Let's talk about the net benefit of this to the business. Because if you're asking us to help because this is a net benefit to the business, then absolutely. If you're asking us to do this because this is work that you don't want to do and you think other humans should do it, then I would say, maybe we should go back to OP1 and figure a way to automate ourselves out of this situation.
For sure.
Right? I'm still always telling my team that our job is to put ourselves out of a job, right? Like our job is to continually find ways to mm-hmm. either use automation or to make sure that we are driving detections down to a state where one day you go, well, why don't we have a SOC? And I'll be able to tell you, you know, once upon a time, we did have a SOC and that SOC went through and looked at all these different ways to be able to say, you know, we don't need to do this, or this could be automated, or this could be better, or we could push this upstream into a state where the SOC is no longer needed. That's my goal. I don't know if we'll ever get there, but it's certainly a goal to keep driving towards.
Well, that I actually had a question for you about that. You know, if you were to look into your crystal ball, what does the SOC of the future look like? And I guess a different way to ask that question is, if you had a blank slate, how would you build out a SOC capability today?
I would say I'm looking at capability, because that's what it really comes down to. Or what is the capability that you gain from a SOC? What is the mm-hmm. capability that you lose by not having a SOC or by outsourcing a SOC? The difference between the outsourcing part of that is, you know, you've got the company's interests first, mm-hmm. right? And that's the reason why you want an in-house SOC.
Sure.
If you can afford it.
And I guess internally, you're also going to have a knowledge of the business that an external party wouldn't have.
Absolutely.
Right.
You're going to know who to go to. The other part of it, of being in-house, is your capability, right? Back to the capability. Make sure that you're focused on what you're delivering specifically for the business. And I think that, you know, you can be able to constantly tweak that because you're in those other meetings, like mm-hmm. strategic planning meetings. So as they're flowing down, you can understand that, okay, this is our new North Star. This is where we've changed course, right? You can't do that if you're outsourced at the same pace.
Right.
And because business is moving so fast, right, you want to make sure that those people who are making those downstream actions are connected to the people who are making those strategic decisions, and therefore they're able to pivot really quickly. And that's one of the benefits of having an in-house. I would look at all of those things and I would say the capability, the North Star strategically that I've outlined, what type of protection posture am I looking for? And then what is my risk if I miss?
Right.
And when I think about that, I'm going to go, do I want to be, if that happens, can I look my customer in the eye and say I did everything possible to make sure this didn't happen? Or am I going to punt? And I'm going to say it was the other guy.
I love it. With sort of the speed that technology is advancing, and, you know, of course, with the generative AI tools that are out there, what do you see being that sort of future SOC? I don't know if you can speak to if you're using any generative AI tools today, or you plan on doing it, or investigating, whatever the case may be, but how do you see that
helping your SOC analysts and the other roles as well? And then from a attacker side, you know, how are you thinking about how they may be using it so that you can either detect their activities or react to them?
We're starting to use it in a way of, you know, creating automated responses for some of our customers. And then we're also looking, you know, at automated workflows to be able to say, okay, we know that these are common workflows that come in. You know, these are things based off our metrics that we're looking at that customers are looking for a lot. How do we incorporate, you know, what our data is telling us with a more direct routing to the solutions that they're looking for, and where they don't require human judgment, why don't we remove the human completely from that chain?
Got it.
And that's what we're working on right now.
That's fantastic.
Yeah.
And then from the sort of adversary side. The
threat side is a real interesting one. You know, it's such a new playing field, right? So you're hearing so many different new things about, you know, injections into, you know, people want to play with, you know, the technology. Mm-hmm. They're just running out to all websites and just downloading.
Yeah.
They don't even know what they're downloading half the time. You don't want to look, people are going to run into the fire, kind of assess the fire first and look for what is the best point of entry, right? So it's kind of the same thing when we're talking about Gen AI, like what are the, you know, the safe places to go, right? How do we make sure we validate that usage before we incorporate it? You know, what are the different checks that we can run in the background to make sure we say, yeah, we feel really good about what we're doing before we proliferate this? Because once it's in and it starts to propagate, that's not the time to find out that, uh-oh, you did something wrong. Because now you're doing a cleanup and it's, you're trying to catch up to the propagation. And that's just not fun, right? For those of us who've done it before for other things. So you definitely want to look at it from a perspective of doing those pre-checks before you even bring things in. And I think another threat that's tied to that, that we're starting to see, which is probably an uncommon one, is regulation, right? Like it is probably one of the biggest trends I'm starting to see as we start to adopt more and more workloads to the cloud as more and more customers are coming to the cloud, right? We go to more and more different environments, different countries, right? We're starting to see sovereign cloud, you know, pop up in more and more locations. You know, the regulation is something that you actually have to think about that before it was kind of an afterthought. And now it's at the forefront of a lot of our discussions before we go in and think about anything else is, you know, how are we able to, you know, adopt and comply and still operate and maintain maximum value for the customer while also being in compliance and being able to communicate that.
I think that is a incredible trend I've seen as well. It used to be we could have the conversation around security by design, right? Build security in, maybe even just in the prototyping stages, ideation stages of things. And now we're at the point where, oh yeah, and privacy and compliance and regulatory obligations as well.
So absolutely.
I'm glad that you're seeing that people are pushing it further down into the stack. So then when it comes to release time, you're actually aligning with things.
Absolutely.
Well, this has been fantastic, Tom. I really appreciate your time today. Thank you.
Thank you so much for having me. I really appreciate it as well.